Welcome to such a bombastic and revealing episode of the StageLeft podcast. We are having to release this in two parts. When you have an artist on who's worked with quite so many people as Jamie Moses has, you simply have too many brilliant stories to tell into one episode. So this is going to be spread across two episodes. The next one will be available in about a week or so. Just to let you know, we have a live version of the podcast, StageLeft Nights, at our lounge in Vauxhall, coming up in October. Tim Hinckley, who's worked with the likes of Rolling Stones and Van Morrison, is going to be coming in. We're going to do one of our supper clubs. So as many of you may well know that my partner is, I'm very lucky, she's an award-winning chef who does incredible food. And we run these things called StageLeft Night Supper Club. And we have people from like Clive Deamer from Radiohead Games One, and John Woff from the 1975. And we've had Emily Barker, She Drew the Gun, Jess from Noel Gallagher's band as well. And they do a live performance in our lounge. So that's going to be coming up. So get in touch with us if you want to come to that. It's a very special evening. It's only to eight people. There's only eight people in the room, and the artist and myself. So this episode came about by chatting to Chris Sharrock at an after show of Noel Gallagher's gig at the Palladium, which I was very lucky to be a guest of. And we went for a drink afterwards. And I was introduced to Katie, whose husband is a saxophone player in Noel's band, and subsequently found out has also played for many years with Jamie Moses. And that's when kind of the whole thing's, oh, my dad was in Queen for these many years, and we kind of put the pieces together and put this episode together. So a special thank you to Katie. She showed brilliant photos of her wedding, where it had pictures of Brian May was there, and it was really, really fascinating to kind of see that connection. So thank you to her. And so for more episodes while you're waiting for part two, featuring Steve Cropper, Tony Visconti, Richard Fortus of Guns N' Roses, Clive Deamer, and being live drummer for Radiohead, and loads more, go to thestageleftpodcast.com. Follow us on Twitter at the StageLeft Pod. Like us on Facebook at facebook.com/StageLeftPodcast, where we have loads of discussion in there. We've got large numbers of people who have kind of discuss every episode in there, as well as the Instagram page as well. So you see behind the scenes photos of when we recorded with Jamie Moses, he let me play a guitar that he and Keith Richards had played. So there'll be photos on the Instagram for that. And other upcoming episodes are with Tim Staffel, who was in Smile when Brian May and Roger Taylor were in the band, and his leaving paid the way for Freddie Mercury, which you see in Bohemian Rhapsody. And Mo Pleasure as well. We got Mo Pleasure on. So he was bassist for Michael Jackson for the This Is It tour that never took place due to Jackson's untimely passing. So they're both going to be really fascinating, aren't they? So, they're going to be coming up soon. We're recording those this week. But they're probably not going to be quite as fascinating as this one, because, ladies and gentlemen, it's Jamie Moses. Okay, welcome to the StageLeft podcast, lifting the veil on the music industry by telling the stories of those with a unique vantage point. The podcast exists to provide free, educational content for young musicians entering an increasingly complex industry by telling the stories of some of the unsung heroes behind the success. Today we have a man who has shared a stage or a studio with no less than Freddie Mercury, Amy Winehouse, Peter Green, Roger Daltrey, Pete Townsend, Nick Mason, Brian May, Slash, U2, Paul McCartney, Keith Richards, Lionel Richie, and many, many more. And today we'll be discussing what tips Jamie can give us mere mortals live and in the studio, and what he learned from playing enormous shows as part of Queen and Paul Rogers, what it was like being stage left to Brian May in his first shows after Freddie passed, and what it was like sharing a microphone with Paul McCartney in exactly the same way Macca and George Harrison did on the very Ed Sullivan performance that influenced Jamie to pick up a guitar in the first place. So it's a pleasure to say, our guest down the stage of podcast, tie your mothers down, it's Jamie Moses. Thanks for joining us today, Jamie. How's it going?
That's fine, Chris. Yeah, thanks for having me. This is fun.
Good stuff. So you've just come back from a tour. You're playing a lot of gigs at the moment and going forward. So you've been with Paul Young, and you're going on another tour as the Los Pacaminos with Paul Young as well. Is that right?
Yeah, well, we're constantly touring with the Pacaminos, or the Pacs, as we call it. But it's been a long old schlep with Paul. We've just done 3 months, really. UK, Europe, and Japan. And now I'm on a bit of a break, about 2 or 3 weeks off, and it's, boy, do I need it.
How does the prospect of touring sit with you these days?
Well, it's great, but I've got a young family, and Charlie's 9, and if I go away for more than a couple of weeks, I come back and he's actually taller, his face has changed, he's using different phrases, he's growing up without me, and I really don't like that, so... You know, if I'm when I say it's a 3-month tour I've just done, I've been back and forth all the time.
Mm.
But that's how touring is now, isn't it, really? Because it's not like you used to go back in the 70s and the 80s. I would go away for 2 months, 3 months, and not come home and not be able to afford the phone calls from the hotel rooms,
wow.
which were about, you know, £10 a minute or something yeah. ridiculous. So so nowadays you do come back because you can afford to get on a plane or, you know, or you can fly the family out and so on. So dog there.
Yeah, that's great. So what's the name of your dog as well? I bet you miss the dog as well.
That's Rosie. Well, we've only had Rosie for about 5-6 months. She's a rescue dog.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so yeah, she miss hers as well, yeah.
So we're in your studio at home now. Tell us what this studio means to you and what perhaps your kind of fondest memories are being in this studio.
Well, I tell you, there's been a bit of recording done in here. I mean, I know it doesn't sort of look like much, but you don't need that much now to do a decent album or a decent recording. We did the Pax last album, quite a big chunk of it, most of it here, actually. I did an album with Cheryl Baker, which I produced and put everything on. That was, we finished that about, geez, that took, well, the thing is, it took us over a year, that one, because we just did it when we had some downtime, both of us. So we had, or both of our schedules had to come together at the same time. But I did that. I've done sessions from here for all kinds of people. There's an album of duets with Kevin Pori. He produced that one. Dave Mindell, a band of sisters, did that one. Lots of stuff. So, you know, I've had some great times in here. And
is it soundproofed? Or do the neighbours complain?
No, it's really quiet. It's really quiet around here. It's a no-through road. Yeah, it's fine. It's a quite a thick, you know, built room. It doesn't need soundproofing, really. It's fine.
So the Los Pacaminos coming up. You've got gigs pretty much in every major town and city coming up from next month, for, you know, the next year, actually. There's loads and loads of gigs, and also you're doing the stuff with Spikes All Stars as well. The Los Pacaminos gigs, you say you don't have to rehearse for those. That amazes me.
Well, when we first put the band together back in 92, we got together in, I can't remember where it was, a little rehearsal studio in North London somewhere, and we had about 3 days to whip the set into shape.
Mm.
And there were a lot of covers in there as well. Just, you know, covers of Ry Cooder things, Little Feet, and covers of sort of Tex-Mex, more Tex-Mexy things as well. And Gangster of Love, and even there's a Roy Orbison song in there somewhere, as I recall. But, so, and once we got that together, because, again, it's one of these things where we all go off and we do other things. We all play with other bands.
Mm.
Paul's got his solo career. I've got the SAS band. At the time, I was doing stuff with the Pretenders and with Mike and the Mechanics and Geldof and going off to do all this stuff, as were the others. And some of them weren't even in other bands, not professional musicians, but they've got other stuff, music management or working for a lighting company and stuff like that. So we just get together to do that, kind of at weekends, and that slowly got a little bit more serious. And we said, hey, let's do an album, which we did. And then 15 years later, we did another one, regular, like just like clockwork, because there was a demand for it, you know. So, and we got a couple of live albums now that we've done. And so it's turned into quite a thing. They're really good tracks, you know, on these albums. It got some good songs. Drew Barfield, he's one of the singers and songwriters in the band, and then Paul Young, does lead vocal, I do lead vocal, so we got three. We did have Matt, the keyboard player and accordion player, who sadly died a couple of years ago now, so we lost him, but we got three lead singers in the band, and that...
Singing harmonies between, or taking turns?
No, lead vocals.
Oh, nice.
Oh, yeah. With harmonies, we got Woody, he sings harmonies, so does Melvin, the pedal steel player. And Steve, the bass player, he's got that really high, reedy voice, which is just terrific, as a lot of bass players do, weirdly. You know, Timothy B. Schmidt with the Eagles, he's got the really high through the roof thing. He does all that stuff.
Yeah.
And before him was, with the Eagles, was Randy Meisner, same voice.
Mm.
He sang Take It to the Limit.
Yeah,
all that
yeah.
stuff on the end.
And so that high reedy voice.
It seems to be a thing with bass players.
There you go. You were self-taught as a guitarist. What bad habits do you have now that you tell a young musician not to have?
Biting my calluses, as I'm doing right now.
But from a technical point of view, what bad habits do you think you have that you'd advise someone not to do?
Well, I'll tell you the first thing to do, actually, that I should have done, and I started to do it and gave it one, don't need it, is learning to read music. And I should have done that. I know I should have. Because it makes it easier to communicate with other... It's like being on a desert island and nobody else... Well, it depends who you're mixing with, but, you know, and you speak a different language to everybody else. How are you supposed to communicate? So, I mean, I can, and I can read chord charts pretty well. And other than that, if somebody hums a melody to me, I can play it straight back to you. So that's not a problem, but it's just, I would say that. And what else? Oh, bad habits. Bad habits, good question. Getting annoyed at having to set your own equipment up.
Mm-hmm. Is that a recent thing, or is that something?
No, last 10, 15 years. Yeah. I've been spoiled, really.
Yeah.
With road crews and stuff, and I walk onto the stage. They hand me a guitar. I do the gig. Wonderful. Give it back to them. Say, you're a man. Thank you very much. And thank you. Good night. And off you go. And don't see it again till. The next time you do it, the next night. And that's great. I love that. Because I'm not one of these people who's going, right, I'll take that guitar home, I'll just do that work on it and fix it. I'm just going to tweak that. I just don't, because as long as it sounds good and it's fine, it's just why mess with it?
So you were brought up, I think you were born in Chicago, is that right?
No, I was born in Ipswich.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, wow. My dad was in the US Air Force. He was stationed here when he met my mum, who was English, in the RAF. And he was stationed at, is it Bentwaters there, near Ipswich? And then by the time I was four, we moved to the States.
Yeah.
Where I was brought up and did all my schooling. Right. He was from Chicago.
Right, okay. But I believe you also were in Japan at some point in your childhood as well?
Once we did 10 years in America, and then he got stationed in Japan, so we all went there, 2 years there.
Where was that, Okinawa?
No. It was near Fukuoka, right. on Kyushu, the southern island.
Yeah,
A place called Itazuki Air Force Base. And I made some really good friends there, and I had a fantastic band called The Inferno with Errol Brown on drums.
Really?
Yeah. Not that Errol Brown.
Okay.
But this guy, and I met up with him last year in Denver, I think it was. And he was our drummer. He's a black guy. He's fantastic. He's one of my best friends ever. So good. I couldn't stop hugging him and kissing him when I saw him last year. Because I've lost touch with all of my friends that when I was, you know, when you're 14, 15 years old, you remember those people a lot, you know? And I was there for 2 years, which is the longest I've been anywhere, really, because we moved around so much with the Air Force.
Because you went to 11 different schools, I believe.
Yes, I did, exactly.
What do you think that impact has on someone's learning and development?
I think it has good and bad pros and cons, because I mean, on the downside, you don't get to make any friends or to get established in any one way of learning things, because it changes every time you move, especially if you go from country to country.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, you're exposed to different ways of doing things, and you go, maybe that's a better way to do it. And I always came in halfway through the music classes, so sometimes they were full, and I couldn't get into the music classes, which is really pissed me off. But there you go, you got to just grin and bear it. And then I just sort of taught myself,
If you had someone who, one of my best mates just had a kid, and he's luckily him and his partner, they've got jobs that mean they don't have to be in a particular place, they can do them remotely. And their plan for the first kind of few years of the child's life is to go to different places so that child experiences lots of different things and may end up in different schools, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Do you think that is a how do you think that will work out for that child's development? Do you think that will would you advise for that, or would you say that's not something you should do? And it's a very difficult question to ask, but
yeah,
from your very, very few people have had that experience that you have, so it's been interesting from a development point of view.
I guess that's true. I suppose it makes you resilient, because you have to adapt to whatever conditions you find yourself in, and you know, you might have to mix with people you don't want to mix with, and it teaches you to kind of be sociable, and of course I suppose it can take you either way, that you either love traveling or you hate it. And I've from the day I left school when I was 17, I was a pro musician, and that's all I've ever done. I had about 2 months working in a shop in West Croydon, music shop in West Croydon. That was funny. But that didn't last. It didn't suit me. That's what I was used to as a kid. And I often wonder if it was because of that that I ended up being a traveling salesman in a way, you know what I mean? or if it wouldn't have made any difference. I don't know.
Where gives you that sense of home? So obviously you're in your home right now, but where you know, sometimes when we grow older and we go back to somewhere that kind of gives you that sense, I feel home. Where is that, given that you've travelled so much?
That's here.
It is.
It's right here. Because I was with my first wife and my two grown-up kids now, Katie and Ben, who are fantastic, by the way. We were in Caterham, which is the next sort of town along. We were there for 20 years. This just feels, I mean, it's not that far. It's only a mile and a half away.
Yeah.
But this area definitely is my home. And of course, and now we're moving down to the West Country. So that's a real wrench. But
how will that impact?
I can feel London spreading out.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And there's more people, it's more crowded, there's more people gobbing on the pavements, and you know, there's just a lot of antisocial behaviour, which wasn't here. I remember this village in the 70s. I used to come here in the 70s because I lived in Limpsfield, which is only 5-6 miles away down there, with a couple of bass players. We all shared a house, three of us, and it was a bit carnage. But anyway, we would come here to this pub, the White Lion, which has been there since the 15th century. Beautiful pub.
Wow.
Great pub. And it was fantastic. Maybe it's just, you know, rose-tinted glasses or something. But I go in there now, it's just not the same place. Yeah.
What does Chicago mean to you? So that was where your father was born, is that right?
It's where he was born, but we never lived there. We lived in a place called Rantoul, Illinois, which is near Champaign, Illinois, which is about 100 miles south of Chicago.
Right, wow, okay.
So it is just in the middle of the cornfields.
Wow.
But there's an Air Force base there.
Right, okay.
Chanute, I think, yeah. So that's why we lived there. So Chicago doesn't mean much to me, except it's a really cool place. I do like going there because I've been there on tour several times.
You've been Kingston Mines, the bar Kingston Mines?
No, I haven't.
It's the oldest blues bar in Illinois.
Oh, really?
And I've had a few great musical experiences. I'm in my mid-30s, but the most authentic music experience I've ever had was in a bar called Kingston Mines. It was the night after Kingston Mines, yeah. And it's the oldest blues bar in Illinois. And it's I went there the night after Barack Obama got re-elected.
Yeah.
And they had a letter above the urinal from Barack Obama during his first stint of presidency saying what a great bar it is, and people in there celebrating. And it's kind of well known for being a great blues experience and great blues bar. They had like BB King's backing band in there when I was in there and stuff, and it's really small. So if you're ever in Chicago, that's the place to go. Next time you're there, I'm sure
you'll
love
at
some
go.
Point. Cool. So tell us about Merlin.
Oh God. Oh Jesus. Well, that was back in 1821 when the band was formed. It was the first proper band, I guess, proper touring band that I'd been in. Was it? I guess it was. I joined in 1973, and they were called Madrigal at the time, and they were known for being a harmony band, and they, you know, big harmonies. It was really impressive. In a kind of not Beach Boys way, but it was a got an English version. Yes, a bit of that. Anyway, they got discovered by Roger Greenaway, and turned into what he wanted was his own version of The Sweet, or Mud, or the bands that were around at the time, the sort of glam rock things, you know. So he stuck us all in leather cat suits.
Really?
And and feather boas and stuff. And
was that very you at the time, or was it something?
Well, the fact is, the music was me. So it was because it was basically a rock band, is what it was. I mean, a really good rock band. And the bass player had a Fender Precision and a 100 watt Marshall stack, you know. Keyboard player had a C3 Hammond and a, you know, Wurlitzer. In fact, he had, check this out, this, if anybody knows anything about keyboards, imagine being the road crew for this band. He had a Hammond C3, Wurlitzer electric piano, a Hohner clavinet.
Nice.
A Fender Rhodes? No, he didn't have a Rhodes. A double keyboard Mellotron, a mini Moog.
Wow.
And a baby grand piano, which was suspended on scaffolding over the C3.
Wow, really? Wow, that's
with nice. And on the lid of the piano was up like that, and the logo of the band was spotlighted on the...
How cool.
Very cool. And the road crew hated us.
Really? I bet they did.
Imagine. I mean, there were five of them, but even so.
And the mini Moog must have been quite new instrument then. Would that be right around that
well,
time?
Well, no. We turned from Magical into Merlin.
Ah, okay.
But in 75.
Right, okay.
So by which time it was on a lot of records.
Yeah,
So on. I mean, though, we also used an ARP synth. Stevie Wonder was big on ARPs.
Right, okay.
And... But yeah, that was some band.
And you once described them as kind of like a teeny pop band rivaling Queen. Would you stand by that? Or?
No, I don't think it's just, it wasn't me, it was the Melody Maker.
Oh really? Right, okay.
Yeah, the Melody Maker had a 2-page spread on us and said, and it was called, I've got it somewhere, it was called Hype in the Pop Market. And it had to mirrored image of the two bands. It had CBS band Merlin, EMI band Queen. And it listed, you know, who was on guitar, who was on vocals, who was on, and so on. And who was championing this within the production companies and everything. So it was Roy Thomas Baker, Queen, and then Roger Greenaway with us. Turns out one had more success than the other. But I remember when I first started playing with the Brian May Band, which had been in 93, and when we'd been in rehearsals for a couple of weeks, I thought it was safe to bring it up to Brian, and I said, I used to be in a band called, I don't suppose you'd remember, a band called Merlin. He went, you were in Merlin? I said, yeah, we were worried about you. I said, you needn't have been, obviously. But it was like we were the rival bands for about 10 minutes, you know, and then we realised how massively talented Queen were.
What a band. And we'll come on to those in a moment. I just want to go back to the reason you picked up a guitar. In my understanding from the research, was the Ed Sullivan performance of the Beatles. I wasn't around then. It's obviously very talked about, but tell us about that experience and how that changed you in that moment watching that performance.
Yeah. Oh my God. Well, it was in black and white, obviously, because there was no colour TV. I remember sitting there, and I'd heard a couple of things on the radio, but I'd never seen the Beatles. And they came on in these outfits, you know, these grey suits.
Mm.
They looked so cool. And with the hair, which was, you know, longer. Nobody had hair, long hair. Guys didn't have long hair like that. It was all kind of crew cuts and flat tops and stuff, especially in the Air Force.
Yeah.
So, and they were from England, where my mum was from and where I was born, you know. So I thought, this is it. And I saw the guitars. I remember, in fact, see that guitar there?
Yeah.
Gretsch Country Gentleman, 1967. That is exactly what George Harrison had.
Really?
And most of the early stuff, at least. Not very early, but mid-60s stuff, early to mid-60s, was played on one of those. And wow. That's why I got that one. But anyway, I saw the guitars and they looked so cool. And then when I finally saw them in color, I saw that was that beautiful, rich brown, you know. And of course, John had the Rickenbacker 12-string, the little body thing. Mm. And it was just... But I couldn't afford any of those. And I used to go to Dave's Guitar Shop in Rantoul, Illinois, when I was 10. And he had a carousel going round in the window. You remember Dave's Guitar Shop, surely. and he had this carousel slowly turning, Fender branded. And it had a Telecaster and a Precision Bass and a Strat. And there's a white Strat like Hendrix used to play. And I'd stand there waiting for this white Strat to come round like that. And I'd go, press my face up against the glass and follow it round, you know.
Oh, nice.
And eventually I got my parents to buy me a silver tone guitar like that.
Right.
Which I've now got another one of those. It's an old, like a vintage one. But electric guitar for my birthday. And it came with lessons from Dave at Dave's Guitar Shop.
Nice.
in Rantoul, Illinois. So I go along and I'm going past him with my silver tone guitar from Sears and Roebuck, you know, catalog guitar. And I feel a bit, still looking at this Stratocaster going by. And I say to Dave, do you mind if I, can I just have a go? He says, I'd rather you didn't really. I went, oh, God, all right, okay. So I go up into this little room and he's teaching me, Michael, row the boat ashore, hallelujah. I'm going, I don't want to learn this shit. I really don't. How about bringing in the sheaves? What are you doing to me? I don't want to do this. I want to learn, I want to hold your hand. Yeah. Or Honky Tonk, actually Honky Tonk Women wasn't out then, but you know, Satisfaction. Yeah. Or it's a Holly's song, or something like the Monkees, whatever. Hey, son, you gotta walk before you can run. Bollocks, you know, absolute bollocks. It's just as easy to play Satisfaction. Easier.
Yeah.
Down. You can play. I can teach anybody. I can teach. Well, you play guitar anyway. Yeah. Anyway, I can teach my dog to play that now, and then you'd be playing it, and it would give you encouragement. You know. But no, he said these, and it came, the guitar came with this course of lessons. I went home, I said, Dad, you're wasting, the guy is a charlatan, he's a thief. He also was charging them to change, well, for the strings, he'll need new strings about every two lessons. So
what?
Yeah, I know, exactly. And then he was charging again to change the strings, of course. So, I mean, I said, Dad, nah, this guy, Dave, he needs to be taught a lesson, you know, forget it. So I taught myself.
And years later, you shared the microphone with Paul McCartney.
Yes.
Which is the coolest photo. Honestly, that is just as good as it gets.
Like, it really is.
And so just for listeners, there's a great moment on the Ed Sullivan performance, particularly on All My Loving. I'll play a clip of it now, actually, where George Harrison comes in and sings the sweetest harmony with Macca, playing that very guitar that you just mentioned. And then years later, tell us all about that day from beginning to end, how that came about that you shared
they did that all the time. They would always do that, and to this day we call it beadling on a mic.
Oh, really?
I mean, you share a mic.
Yeah.
I do it with Paul Young all the time.
Cool.
We get, and there's no reason for doing it, except it's like a buddy thing, you know?
Yeah.
And I do, yeah, so everybody does it. But
did anyone do it before then?
I think they might have done, because out of necessity, because there would only be two mics up,
true.
So they would beadle up on the mic. It's not ideal because you don't get, if one guy's out of tune, especially if you're recording it, then it's ruined.
Mm.
Or if one guy's loud, if the balance isn't right, it's not going to come out in a live situation.
Mm.
Or so you got less control over it. But anyway, the Beatles just did it so well. You listen to those recordings, there's no trickery, there's no computers, it's just... them, it's just talent. And they were not just singing, they were playing really well too, and they wrote the songs. That's what's not around.
And they're all about 18 or 19 at the time.
Yes.
It dawned on me the other day that yesterday McCartney wrote that age like 21 or 22.
Oh,
it sounds such like a reflective, like Jesus. Older person reflecting on their life. It's like, no, he's only 21 22.
Yeah.
It's crazy, isn't it? Yeah
Yeah, there's another thing, like Jackson Browne, that's another one. He wrote, was it The Pretender, when he was 17, I think, something really? Like that. Yeah, and it's got a line in that, caught between the longing for love and the struggle for the legal tender.
Wow.
You know, so he's on the road making money, but he's, you know, he's missing his
heart.
His
girl, somewhere. His heart. Yeah. Wow, amazing.
How do you write that when you're 17?
Yeah, it's crazy.
I mean, maybe he's 18 or something, but that's what I was told.
And in my life, Lennon wrote that at same kind of age, 21, 22. It's like, you think that sounds like someone in his 40s reflecting back or that kind of thing, but yeah, incredible. So to tell us about how you ended up, so was it his daughter's birthday thing. Or something?
Like yeah, that? It was Mary's birthday. It's her 25th birthday, which is why we're all wearing... dressed in ridiculous silver jackets and things.
Because McCartney's wearing a dress.
No, he's wearing...
Is he not?
It's okay. It looks like a chain mail thing. There's a picture up over there. Yeah. It's like a... it almost looks like a chain mail top, which happens to come down to about there.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, I know. It does look like a dress, doesn't it? Yeah, and he's with Linda as well. Who's the two of them were out, passed this lift back and forth on the dance floor while we were playing.
So were you asked to play this gig by Mary, by Paul? Was it? Did they turn
do you
up?
No. I can't remember. No, because I didn't know them before that. It was somebody I knew at the time. Maybe their publicist or something. I can't remember. But anyway, this band was known for doing... We did stuff for Tina Turner and did her birthday and for Mike Rutherford and Brian and Roger and stuff. This was maybe before that. No, maybe not. I can't remember when it was. 2000?
Was it as late as that?
Oh, maybe earlier. Maybe earlier. Can't remember.
Yeah.
But anyway, so we turn up there and we set up and we meet him, and he's fantastic. Really, really nice guy to put your ears. He says to our drummer, who was a Scouser, he says, oh, so what part of Liverpool are you from? And Tony told him whatever it was. And he says, oh, the posh bit. Really? But anyway, and I said to him, well, listen, we're planning on playing birthday, you know, and A, you wrote it, and B, it's your daughter's birthday, so you fancy jumping up and singing it, you know, with us. He said, yeah, sure. He says, as soon as I hear the strains of the tune, I'll jump up. So I catch his eye on the back of the room, you know, like, oh. Down. He makes his way down the front, and he grabs a tambourine, and he comes over, and I can see he's about to beat with me on the mic because it's all in harmony. That say it's your birthday, down. So just before the first line comes, because it's a longish intro, he leans right into me and he goes, "I can't remember the fucking words." he goes, "You sing it." I went, okay, so I guess it's just my birthday too, yeah. Do, do, do. Say, you're going to have a good time. Glad it's your birthday. Happy birthday to you. And then this long thing, if you know the song, it goes, birthday, I would like you to dance. Birthday. And of course, and then he starts singing. He comes in. I would like you to dance. Take a chance. And I'm going, yes! Yes! It's just all my Christmases came at once. That's fantastic. And then he sang the rest of the song with me on the mic.
Really? Oh, yeah. Wow.
Fantastic. I mean, Spike, normally, my old friend Spike Edney from Queen.
Yeah.
He normally does the... Spike Edney from Queen. He normally does the harmony thing with me. But he kind of backed off when he saw that.
Awesome.
That Macca was going to do it.
And did you meet him again years later at the Queen's Jubilee gig as well?
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes, yeah. I did.
You were playing with Tom Jones at that.
He was in the dressing room next door, and we both happened to walk out of the dressing rooms at the same time, and I said, "Oh, Paul," I said, "Yeah, you probably won't remember me." He said, "We played at Mary's 25th, my band." He says, "Yeah, oh yes, of course I do." And he grabbed my face like this, and he said, "How are you doing, cheeky boy?"
Nice.
Yeah, he's a nice guy, really nice guy.
Well, that's an incredible, you know, whatever you achieve in your life, that is something every musician would, you know, love that. So
that's exactly what I think.
And that's built on a lot of hard work over the years, so it's a great stuff. All my lovers, I listen to you. All my lovers, darling, are the truth. about, let's bring up the Q word. So let's bring up Queen. So obviously you first started playing with Brian May quite, it was the year after I think Freddie passed away.
Yes,
which must have been quite a surreal and unusual time for him. And I think he referred to that as therapy, Brian did. And he was kind of trying to channel that grief into a positive creative outlet. How was that for you? And, you know, I watched a gig last night, basically, and this crowd's really singing along, really kind of loving it. It's like a celebration.
Not but
at the
Adam.
Same time... No, sorry, these are the Brian May Brixton ones.
Oh, I see. Like,
yeah. So quite soon afterwards. That must have been quite a surreal time, playing those songs.
It was. We were all pretty nervous, but nobody was more nervous than Brian about
really?
The whole thing. Well, he'd never sung lead vocal in a band before, but he's perfectly capable, I tell you. You know, so a part of his worry, part of the reason he had me, was that his biggest worry, I think, was being able to play and sing at the same time. Because there's some pretty heavy-duty guitar parts stuff. And some pretty heavy-duty vocal things. So, you know, he wanted me there for doing that. But it was, and we had girl singers and that he'd never had before. And what was the first one? Was it Brixton Academy?
Well, I know that you released a live album quite soon after there called...
Do you know, I think that was our first gig.
Yeah, I think it
and
was.
And everybody went, really? You're going to record the first gig and make it into a video? But it turned out okay. It was fine.
It's still on YouTube. I watched it for an hour and a half.
Yeah, Cozy thundering away and Neil.
Yeah, and he did a long drum solo halfway through Cozy.
Yes, he did. And that stayed with us, that thing. Yeah.
So how did he go from being kind of a stage left musician, Brian, to being centre stage? Did you sense the challenge for him around that? And how did you support him in that?
I just did whatever he asked me to do, really. Yeah. You know, a bit of harmony lead and so on. And, well, just encouraged him as much as we all did. As much as we could, say, yeah, you can do this. You sing this stuff great. And he does. And that's that. But, that went on for some time, didn't it? The Brian May Band thing. Till 99, 98, 99, I think. And then we lost Cozy, of course, sadly.
I was going to ask about that. So what did the band lose as a musician and as an individual? What did they lose on that?
Well, I mean, the thundering presence. And, you know, this Cozy is the ultimate rock, was the ultimate rock drummer. He just, you know, if there was a change coming up and you're going to the middle eight or going to the chorus, he would go boom, and you know that it's coming, you know.
Right.
There was nothing ambiguous about that. You know, he's going fucking there you go, have that, this bit is coming up. He'd send you a telegram saying and as a guy he was hilarious. And he's such a nice guy.
So what were the specific challenges joining Queen? Because I think you've said in the past that was one of the most, technically, that was one of the most challenging things that you'd had to do at that stage. Did you have to do an audition for that? How did that come about? I mean, I'm guessing the Queen element came through the Brian May thing. So how did you get to know Brian first so that you ended up being in that position? Did you have to audition?
Well, the first day I met Brian was at the Freddie tribute at Wembley when I was playing with Geldof.
Oh, right, you played with Geldof, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Wow. That was a huge gig. That was televised. Yeah,
yes, it was.
At Wembley Stadium?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So, and we were on immediately before Spinal Tap. it's just me, Bob, and Alan Dunn on accordion, just the three of us.
What did you play? Can you remember?
We played a song called Too Late, God, and which is just slide guitar and accordion and Geldof punching away at an acoustic guitar, and we played it was a hit. Oh no, we did a Redemption song.
Bob
Marley,
nice.
You know,
yeah, nice.
And we might have done one other, but I think it might just been those two. And on that day, Spike was there, who I knew from Merlin days, because he had a band called Smiling Hard. And we were kind of, I wouldn't say rival bands, because they were a groovy, funky, hip band.
Yeah.
And we were this kind of glam rock thing.
Yeah.
But we were all, you know, when you strip away all that, we were all friends. So when we'd get together a lot on the road, we'd meet up. And So, and he said, oh, listen, I've got this. Oh, and also he and I had been in the Geldof band together.
Right, okay. So that was a link as well.
And he kind of jumped ship with Geldof to go with Brian, because Brian was just starting to think about forming this band, the Brian May band.
Yeah.
And so he said, oh, I want you to come and meet Brian. So he took me into his dressing room and I met him there for the first time. And then they asked me to come and audition at Nomus Studios, which I doubt is there anymore in London, for the Brian May band. And I went along and I did the audition. And it was I wasn't so much nervous as excited to be playing with Brian May.
Nice.
You know? I nearly said Brian fucking May, in case you wanted to cut it out.
That's fine. Swearing's allowed.
Oh, great. And I said to him, and it's the God's honest truth, I said to him after the audition, he was really complimentary about my sound and my playing and everything. I was just knocked, blown away.
Wow.
And I said to him, if I don't get this gig with you, I completely understand, but it's made my year, my decade, to just have stood and played with you.
Wow.
Because he is, still is, I could, five guitar players I could name, most of them are dead, Hendrix and whoever, but, and Jeff Beck, who I've played with several times since. Yeah, nice. Yeah, he's great, he's fantastic, yeah. What a guy. I don't know how he does that. It's like witchcraft, whatever that shit is that he does. He does it with his fingers, and does he got the tremolo arm between his fingers there, and he's doing that stuff, and I don't know. That he's terrific. Brian is one of those guys. And it's true, just to have done that a bit. But then when they called up and said, yeah, we want you to be in the band, I went, then I got nervous.
And tell us how you, because he's got a very particular tone that he creates, and how easy was it to adapt your style to playing some of those songs, given what you just said, that he's one of the five greatest guitarists,
yes,
and you had to fill those boots while he's doing the vocals.
No way you can do it, because he is unique, and by definition that means you can't duplicate it. I've got, see that guitar at the end there,
yeah,
it's a Brian May Super, which is Brian very kindly kind of had made for me.
Oh, nice.
And it's one of the top the range Brian May guitars. They will sound more like his guitar than any other.
Right.
But even then, it's that thing about, it's in his fingers and in his head. And he plays with a sixpence, which has got the serrated edge on it.
Really?
So, yeah, yeah.
I didn't know that. Wow.
So the difference, I'll just...
Yeah, that's fine.
Well, hold on, I'll play it on electric.
James is going to get a guitar.
I'm getting a guitar. I need a coin. And of course, but the sixpence is really small. So it's a pound coin, I guess they'll do it. He can hold that, and he's got very delicate kind of fingers.
Yeah.
I can't make the sixpence work, so I was using a 10 pence piece. Yeah. And that helps a lot because it digs in. If you get this. There's not much. Now that's with a pick, and you play it with a coin. If you get more gain on it, you could hear it more. But it's got more. You get more attack with a coin. It's a pound is a bit thick, actually.
Yeah. But, oh, wow. I never knew he played with that. Right, okay. That kind of makes sense.
Yeah,
right.
He does.
Are you not at risk of breaking strings and stuff like that? I mean, get back to Dave in Illinois.
Yeah, no, Dave's guitar shop. Yeah. Dave the rip-off man. He'll
make a load of money.
But,
you're not at risk of breaking strings with...
Yes, he used to break a lot of strings because he used to use... his gauges were something like... For any guitar players out there, we're like dog claws. Brian's gauges were more like, it was something like 8, 9, 10, and then it got slowly. But they were like hair. The strings are just so light, such light gauge, and he was breaking strings all the time. And And he said, what gauges do you use then? And because not familiar, you know. Yeah. And I said, well, at time, I'm using 10s now, but I was at the time I was using 9s, and that would be 9, 12, 15, 22, 32, 42. This is real guitar player stuff, yeah, isn't fine. It?
Yeah.
So it's only guitar. Everybody
no, that's
else
really been, insightful.
Other people are going, what is he talking about?
Well, it's getting that unique tone, like that unique sound that Brian May created, and it's really interesting to get that.
Yeah, that's it. But as a result, he broke loads of strings, and then he swapped over to 9s.
Oh, did he? Right.
Yes, and I, as far as I know, that's where he's still. And he doesn't break so many strings, but he still does. I mean, he plays very gently. He's a light player. He doesn't go growl.
Yeah. You know. It's very subtle.
And even when he looks like he's doing that, he's not. Not so much.
Said the volume on stage was the loudest you'd experienced. How are your ears these days?
I was going to say pardon, but no, I'm not going to do that. They're fine, thanks.
Good, yeah.
Fine. I've come away, touched loads of wood. I've come away kind of unscathed, more or less. I do have trouble in a crowded room, but it's probably my age because I'm nearly 130 now. in a crowded room, if I was talking to you now, we'd be closer. But all the background noise would, I'd have trouble focusing on one voice.
Do you use in-ears now at your gigs? Yeah. Or do you? Oh, you do, right, okay. Yeah,
yeah, almost. Well, not with the Pacaminos. This is because the Pacaminos is just a spit and sawdust bar band, really, at the end of the day. So, we don't. But, with most other acts, yes.
One question I had about with the Queen stuff, whether it be with Brian May or with Queen, that must have stretched your vocal range. I mean, you're a great singer, but some of the high parts on that are just really high. Did it stretch your vocal? Was that a challenge or did you?
With Queen and Paul Rodgers, yeah, but then Roger, he sings through the roof. You know, he's got a hell of a range, Roger. Yeah.
So he would do the highest parts, would he? Or?
Yeah, the only bit that I used to do, which I probably couldn't do now, but it's that bit in Under Pressure where it goes,
just before the outro. Yeah, I know exactly the bit you mean.
Love.
Yeah, nice.
Can we give love all the bait? Yeah. But even then, sometimes it just wouldn't come off, you know.
Well, did you play in different keys for Paul Rodgers?
Some. We did I Want to Break Free. We dropped that down a tone, I think. Crazy Little Things the same. I think it was only... I think it was only I Want to Break Free, which was in... we changed it. I think we changed that down. Changed that down to D, I think.
Right.
Yeah. But no, Paul's a great singer.
Yeah.
You know, he can handle all kinds of stuff. But Fred had such a range on him, and it didn't sound like it.
Mm.
It was deceptive. You listen to Paul's... Fred sing, and you think... Well, yeah, no, no, that's still, yeah, I'll do that. Okay, here we go. 2, 3, 4, go. Shit.
And you did one gig with Freddie, is that right?
I did, yeah.
Was that? Well, tell us about that.
Oh, again, I'm hazy on the year, but it was, well, I'll tell you what.
Crazy Little Thing Called Love, you played.
Yes, right, that was the single at the time.
Right.
That was, so whenever that was. Do you know when that was?
Yeah.
88, maybe.
I want to say 85, but let me have a look.
Oh, it might have been. It was at the Coliseum in St. Martin's Lane, and I was in the pit with the Royal Philharmonic, weirdly, and a couple of other people, a guy named Rob Rollinson on bass, and can't remember who else was on it. But how I got that, I don't know. But he was on stage with the Royal Ballet, and Dame Margot Fontaine was in the balcony. We were watching him, and he came on wearing like tights. And like a leotard type of thing.
Yeah.
It was hilarious. I mean, it was a little bit tongue-in-cheek, you know. But then he was
And you were playing Guitar.
I was playing guitar. With the they said that, well, that, yeah, there'd be an orchestra in the pit here with you.
Right.
So, you know, kind of get dressed up a bit, come back in the evening. We did a run through with Fred during the day. He was there with, I guess it must have been, what was it?
It was 1980 was the year.
Oh, was it?
1980, yeah. Jesus. He wrote it in 79 and it came out in 80.
How about that? Yeah, that sounds about right, I guess, yeah. So bad with years and things. I'm going to have fuck all to tell my grandchildren. Well, I have loads to tell them. I wonder when it happens.
Just playing this podcast, that's fine.
Yeah, exactly. Thanks. And he said he was with his, I suppose, his boyfriend, which I can't remember his name, but I suppose he was with him. And he said, oh, sounds fabulous, darling. You know, we'll see you this evening. Great. So we go and do it. And, of course, I have to start it out with down, go down, go down, go down, go down.
Let's get the guitar out.
This is a Gibson J45, 1966. Nice. It's a gorgeous.
It's in D, isn't it? Yeah, yeah.
No, it's a J45.
No, it's in D, the song.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
sorry.
Yeah.
So good. So obviously I started out, we rehearse it, the orchestra isn't there. The MD just looks at me and says, go on then, kick it off. So I start, fine. We come to do it in the evening. Suddenly there's this guy in a black suit waving a stick at me. And I'd never played with an orchestra. I mean, in 1980, so I was 25.
Mm-hmm.
I'd never played with an orchestra before.
What was he trying to say?
So he goes, tap, 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 tap. He's got the bat on and he puts it up in the air and goes, down, left, right, up, down. I'm going,
shit.
Don't know. And I can see the panic in my face. So the drummer looks at me and goes, 2, 3, 4. And I went,
nice.
but then, of course, I'm trying to follow this, which is now I know it's, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Right.
Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2.
Right. Oh,
so
nice.
The downbeat is the 2, you know. And of course, but I didn't know that at the time. So, and the orchestra and the band just came in and it was slightly out. But, in my head, it was just a car crash. You know, I felt so bad about it. But if the orchestra had bothered to turn up during the whole point of rehearsal,
or
at least the conductor.
yeah. Or even communicated with you before.
Knowing that I had to start it, they must have just assumed that, hey, these guys are shit hot, you know, readers and session players. So,
whoops.
Yeah.
And so you did that with him. And then going on to the big shows that you did with Queen and Paul Rodgers, when you're on stage on those huge shows, I mean, you did the one in Ukraine to 320,000 people, I think it was. I watched it last night or the night before last. And I wonder, at those big shows, how do you communicate on stage? Where is the spontaneity in those shows? Can you be spontaneous? And if so, how do you communicate on stage?
Yes, that's a good question. Well, Spike is the MD for Queen. So if anybody gets really lost, you look at Spike and he goes, now, yes. Or this is about to happen, you know, or put his hand up in the air when it's the last time round, a solo or something like that. But sometimes Brian either chooses not to see it or just doesn't see it or decides, no, I'm going to go around one more time, which is fine because, you know, if you're not playing the tracks, you've got that luxury and that's fantastic, not playing the tracks like that because so many acts I play with do play with tracks. And that's got its own appeal, you know, but sometimes it's less versatile and there's no spontaneity. It's just, it is what it is. But with Queen, there's very few, I think, that are to track. So, at least there used to be. And I think it's probably still the case. But so it would be on, but especially if Brian is right down the end of the ramp, you know, in going into the crowd, he turns around, he's a long way away. It's hard to see somebody.
So there wasn't any on-stage communication system set up where you could talk to each other?
No.
No. Guns N' Roses use that. They yes. they have these mics on, and it bypasses, so they can speak into the mic and it bypasses what the crowd can hear, and they can communicate on stage to each other.
What, and they were, there's separate mics set up?
Separate mic, yeah, yeah. So we had Richard Fortus on the podcast, and he was saying that Axel will say, well, I want to go one more time round, something like that. It bypasses so the audience can hear it, and that on stage you can hear it in your ears. Yeah.
Clever, what a great idea. Yeah. The other thing, I have heard of bands that have that same system, which works better if you're on a mic stand, if you're handheld and you're wandering around.
Mm.
Not so much, but where there's just a foot switch.
Yeah.
You press it and hold it, it turns the mic off and routes it to the band, or even to the monitor guy.
Mm-hmm.
And then you take your foot off. It's like a dead man's switch. You know, you can't, it won't stay on. You got to...
Yeah. And talk about Guns N' Roses. I think you did a tour supporting
them. Yeah, we did,
them,
yeah.
But then on some of the shows, you headlined. Is that right? So you switched the headline and support slot with Guns N' Roses as the Brian May band. Is that right?
I don't remember that part of it. I don't remember that part of it, no.
But you toured with Guns N' Roses.
We did the World Tour, like? Yeah.
I mean, that was at the time when their shows were really wild.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. They're great shows, actually. They're quite a spectacle. The bit of their shows that I always remember is the Live and Let Die thing, when it's got that long intro, and you were young and your heart was no fun. So live and let die, boom, boom. And they had this bank of aircraft landing lights across the back of the stage, facing the crowd.
Yeah.
Live and let die, boom. These lights had come on, the whole stadium would just light up from these lights.
Wow.
So, yeah, there's that, but I mean, Axel was troubled at that time, shall we say. You know, he stormed off the stage a couple of times.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Run-ins with him? Not, you know, did you bump into him at all? Or,
you know, I literally did, though. I mean, once we've gone around backstage, you know, in the stadiums, you've got the big old sort of areas backstage, the corridors, and I was walking along. We'd done our set with Brian, and he was storming along on his with a microphone in his hand along the corridor, coming towards me, a face like thunder. And I said, "You all right?" "No, not really." He went and just carried on. I said, "Shouldn't you be on?" And I thought, "No, I'll leave it." Because I could hear the band still playing, you know.
One of the questions I've got about Queen and the shows they've done and you've done with them, just your own personal view, how you'd have felt about this. They've never gone down this route, but there's this technology now where you can have holograms and stuff like that. I don't know if you've seen that. And it's been used so brilliantly. I think it was Snoop Dogg had Tupac as a hologram on one of his festival shows a few years ago, which would have been such a head fuck for all the people who are doing drugs and just walking, yeah. What the fuck? Is
yeah,
that, you know?
Yeah, quite right. Yeah.
And there's kind of, and one of the most bizarre uses was ITV did an evening with or an audience with Les Dawson as a hologram, which is a very odd thing and, in my opinion, a bit of a waste of that technology, given that you could reform Nirvana and the Beatles. How would you have felt about if someone had said, right, what we're going to do is we're going to do a show and we're going to use Freddie's hologram and done a whole show? How would you have felt about that?
It would be a bit weird, wouldn't it? I think it would. And I'm not sure how the guys would feel about it. I mean, they might see it as a, you know, an interesting kind of experiment. And that'd be really weird, wouldn't it?
It'd be so weird.
Don't know. Whatever. I mean, I'm just, the thing is, I'm a, you know, a side man. So if they say this is what we're going to do, I say, hey, cool. Fine.
But that's. But I ask, well, how would you feel about it? So yeah. So
yeah,
your decision. But how would you feel?
How would I feel about it? I'd be fascinated, actually.
Mm.
I'd be fascinated to see what it's like. But of course, from my perspective, it would be different, wouldn't it? Because I'd be looking at a different angle, and I wouldn't see what the punters would see, would I?
I don't know how it works. I have no idea. I don't think it's. I don't know if it's 3D or if it would just be. Yeah, I see what you mean. It would just be such a. I think it's going to happen at some point, like with some band. They're going
to
do it. It's bound to happen. I mean, you already got Elvis gigs where the band play with him on a screen behind. So yeah. It's going to happen at some point.
And they'll probably get, you know, Hendrix gigs and all kinds of stuff. Well, I need some old footage and to have the technology to convert that into a hologram. I'm sure within the next 20 years it'll be possible.
Yeah.
And there'll be Hendrix will be on tour again.
Beatles, you know, reform.
So will Beatles, Buddy Holly, they'll all be out there.
and you might be playing some of those gigs. It would just be such a weird experience, wouldn't it? Just be such an odd experience. Yeah. You played with Keith Richards in one of your photos. Is that the same McCartney gig?
No, that's a different one. That was, in fact, that was John Giddings, I think, that organised that one for us. It's that same band that did McCartney's, called the Red Sox at the time, the world-famous Red Sox.
Right.
We've since changed the name to Jamie and the Falcons, by the way.
Oh, nice.
And that's our kind of party band, and we're still doing lots of that kind of thing, you know, sort of pop stars and celebs.
Yeah.
We do parties for. That gig was for Keith's personal, who had died. I can't remember what his name was now, but it was kind of a wake for him at the Half Moon in Putney.
Oh, that's near me.
Is it where do you live?
Vauxhall.
All right, not too far. We play there all the time with the Pacaminos mostly.
Oh, right, nice, yeah.
We did two nights there a month ago.
Right, okay, nice.
A residency. So they booked the Half Moon as a private venue, and Keith and Ronnie were there, along with Keith's brother, which is his name? I can't remember his name. And there was a Jagger there, Jagger's brother as well.
Right, okay. Had he planned to get up, or was it spontaneous that he got up and played?
Spontaneous.
Yeah, nice.
And I can't remember if he asked to, him and Ronnie, or if we asked them, or it was just a... I think I might have just said, we're going to do some rock and roll if anybody wants to get up and join us.
Nice.
You know, kind of thing.
Looking straight at him.
And the two of them just went, show, yeah.
Nice.
They stopped chatting up our backing singers for 5 minutes, and and up they went. And Ronnie got on bass, and because he's a great bass player,
yeah,
Ronnie Wood.
Wow,
he played bass on a lot of the. Didn't he play bass on some of the Jeff Beck stuff?
Oh, did he? I didn't know that. Wow,
I think he did.
He got to play bass.
He got to play bass, and Keith, I gave him my Telecaster, which.
Is it here somewhere?
Yes, it is.
Right, I'm getting a photo of that later.
Yeah, okay. It's in a case in a cupboard with a load of others.
Actually. Awesome.
Keith said, I gave him the Telecaster, and said, look, there's a bottle opener screwed to the back there. I said, if you need one during the course of the gig. And he's very amused, right? He says, oh, wow, I've got to get one of those on mine, right? And it's had the sticker on it. Says, I'm pissed and I've got a gun. So I got a picture of him with that. Yeah. And it's really, I wear it kind of low slung as well. So it's all suited him. And he was kind of leaning on my shoulder, you know, with arm around me like this, you know, the typical Keith pose. Classic. Again, it was one of those days you just don't forget.
What's the most important guitar to you and why that you own?
It's probably my Strat, my black Strat, which I've had, which I bought new in 1983, I suppose it was. It's a Squire Strat. Mm-hmm. It's one of the first Japanese Squire Strats that are now, I suppose, quite valuable. But I've got more valuable guitars, but that one, I've played it for so many years in so many bands, in so many situations. I'm probably playing it in that one with McCartney, am I?
Right.
Anyway, that it's just like an old friend, you know, and I'd be very upset if I, like I say, it's worth less than half of what some other guitars are worth.
Yeah.
But it's like part of me, really.
So that's part one. How great was that? So interesting. And there's loads of great stories in part two. So what we did was we took a break, and then he was like, oh yeah, this is a story about Sacha Baron Cohen, and this is a story about this person. I was like, right, let's get it all in there. So loads of great stories in part two that will be coming up next week. But for, you know, if you want to listen to some more episodes in the meantime that you haven't heard before, we've got people from Kraftwerk, Fleetwood Mac, loads and loads of big bands. So I'm sure you enjoy them. So check it out, and we'll see you next time.